This particular evening, we're joined by Roberta Kaplan and Chris Geidner. Robbie's been a partner with her firm Paul Weiss since 1999. She's been the recipient of several awards and, in fact, will be receiving a Lifetime Achievement Award from the New York Law Journal 1 week from today. And then, as you all know, in 2009, she agreed to represent Edith Windsor until 2013, when the so-called Defense of Marriage Act was finally defeated in the Supreme Court, the story of which is told in her book, Then Comes Marriage. Former President Bill Clinton reviewed the book, saying United States v. Windsor was a landmark ruling, and the case's architect, Roberta Kaplan, emerged as a true American hero. Then Comes Marriage is a riveting account of a watershed moment in our history and the strategy, ingenuity, and humanity that made it happen. In conversation with Robbie today, we have Chris, who is currently a senior political reporter for BuzzFeed and a winner of the NLGJA Journalist of the Year Award. And I know everyone is anxious to get started, so I'd like to hand it over.
Hello, everybody. There we go. Hi. So wonderful to see everybody here to talk with us about Robbie's book. What I'd like to do is just sort of take you through some of the things in the book that really stood out to me, and that I think Robbie will have some interesting insights to add, that are things that even if you did follow the case as it was going along, you might have either not known or missed. With as we go through at points when there are areas where I think I have sort of specific things to add to it, I will do so. I found it really interesting the way that you talked in the book about how Massachusetts came about and how this sort of happened when people weren't really expecting it, after we had gone through Hawaii and got DOMA into law, and then Massachusetts happened, and then you were faced with the prospect of taking on your own case. And you have this New York marriage case that comes along. And can you talk about your decision to get involved in that case and where that came from?
Sure, I mean, you know, I think you're right, Chris. I think what Mary Bonanno did in Vermont and then in Massachusetts in terms of getting the incredible decisions that she did, in a lot of ways, for a lot of gay people, myself included, was kind of out of the blue. I don't think, you know, and I've talked to Mary about this, I mean, I think deliberately she did a lot of her stuff kind of, I'm pretty good at projecting.
She did a lot of her stuff kind of on her own and quite consciously, and I think quite wisely, kept it kind of low key. And then it happened, and then we got this decision from Margie Marshall in the Goodrich case from the Supreme Judicial Court of Massachusetts, and the entire world changed. And with those changes, all of a sudden, you know, people started, it's like when a new thought comes into people's heads that they'd never had before, and this new thought came into people's heads. For gay people, maybe we could get married, and for straight people, like someone like Gavin Newsom, maybe I could marry people. And so that's what he did. And then, of course, there were people who decided that was a good idea, and they'd do the same thing. And there was a kid, I'm old enough to say this now, there was a young guy, he was a mayor of New Paltz, New York, he was in his 20s. Sharon McGowan worked on the case with me, so she would know. In his 20s, right? He was in his 20s, and he decided that, like Gavin Newsom, he was going to marry some gay couples. And that's what he did. And that's what really started the New York marriage case. Now, look, you know, when we brought the New York marriage case, well, let me begin by saying I lost the New York marriage case. We lost it big time. But the world was a very different place. And I remember when I argued that case to the New York Court of Appeals, my philosophy of it was to try to persuade the court, because the only court that had passed marriage equality at that point was the Supreme Judicial Court in Massachusetts. And so my philosophy was, be brave. You know, you're New York. There are a lot of gay people in New York. We have this long tradition of being tolerant toward gay people in New York. Be brave. Follow your own constitution. Do the right thing.
And you said before you even started, before you even got to the podium, something happened that sort of suggested to you that things were not going well.
Yeah, so, you know, look, winning cases is not going to be a surprise to anyone in Washington, D.C. Winning cases is about getting the votes. And when you have a 7-judge court, call me crazy, I'm not that good at math, but even I know you need 4 votes. Supreme Court, you need 5 votes. So we knew that we needed 4 votes on the New York Court of Appeals, and about 2 weeks or so, maybe a little bit more than that before the argument, a judge by the name of Rosenblatt decided to recuse. And from my experiences on that court, I had clerked for Judge Kaye several years before, so I knew a lot of the judges. And from my experience among those judges, we pretty much lost, because I knew that if we were going to win, not only did we need Judge Rosenblatt's vote, but we needed him to actually lobby the other judges to our side. And without him and his ability to do that, we wouldn't win. And unfortunately, I turned out to be right.
And when you were talking about the case, you talked about the fact, for the first time, and this comes back, the idea that as a lawyer in private practice, you have had the benefit of not having a constituency and being able to really focus on your client, the issue, your client or clients, the issue that's in front of you, and not be focused on what an organizational interests are, like when you're talking about the ACLU or Lambda Legal or something. Can you talk about sort of how that enters into your mind?
Yeah, so I'm so honored that my partner, who I've known for many years, former partner Jay Johnson, is here. And Jay, like I, you know, we're poor country lawyers at Paul Weiss. And we're taught by people like my mentors, Marty London and Judge Colleen McMahon, that your job as a lawyer is to represent your client. And everything that you do in a case has to be focused on exclusively on how to win your case for your client. I think I learned some lessons from the New York marriage case in certain ways that I think it's not that we didn't do that, but I think we didn't focus on that enough. And the first way, I think, was that, and this was very typical, I'm blaming myself if I'm blaming anyone, but it was very typical in these cases to bring large groups of plaintiffs. So you would have, and you wanted it to be fully representative. It made sense. So you'd have a woman plaintiff, couple, you'd have a male plaintiff couple, you'd have young, you'd have old, you'd have African-American, you'd have white, the whole gamut. And it makes sense. You want to represent the diversity of the community. And it, frankly, it made sense for a practical reason, too, because if I recall, I think we lost at least 2 plaintiff couples in the New York case because they split up while the case was pending. So you want to have enough that doesn't happen during the case. But the one thing I didn't realize, or I think I didn't realize until after the case, is that if the plaintiffs in the case are 8 couples or 6 couples or 9 couples, then the facts of those couples' lives fade into the background. And what the case seems to look like, or appears to the judges like, is a fight, like a fight between pundits on MSNBC and Fox News. It becomes an abstract fight about gay marriage. And that's not what you want. The way to win these cases, the way we ultimately won these cases, is to persuade judges, first the American people, I think, and then judges, that gay people and their relationships are the same as anyone else. And the way to do that is you have to focus on people and their lives. So one of the huge advantages when I got to the Windsor case is not only was it only one couple, but, and this is, I don't mean to be too sarcastic about this, but there was no chance that they were going to split up because, sadly, Thea had already passed away. So it was the perfect way to kind of present those facts. Not that they would have split up anyway. Let me be clear. Edie, if you're listening to this, let me be crystal clear.
When you did get the decision, you talk a lot about sort of some of the language that was in the majority opinion. And I should say this is in one of those great small world situations. When I was actually a practicing lawyer, we had worked on opposite sides of a case when I was at the Ohio AG's office. And when you were a young lawyer...
I won that case, as I recall.
You did. you had worked with Judge Smith, who wrote the majority opinion.
Who's and your boss's father?
Now, that is also my boss's father, Ben Smith's father. So you got this this decision, and can you talk a little bit about the majority opinion? Because I think one of the things that I was struck when reading the book was remembering the fact that when this decision came down, this was, in a lot of ways, what was expected from that side of the argument.
Right. So I, as I said before, as soon as Judge Rosenblatt recused himself, I expected we would lose the New York marriage case. So I don't think I was surprised at all by the result. I was surprised, and I've talked to Bob about this, so it's not something we haven't talked about. I was surprised by the tone of the opinion. We had gotten an opinion in the intermediate court, the third department, that kind of said what I thought we would get from the Court of Appeals, which is, this is a really hard issue, it's really tough, it's really contentious, people have different views, it's not really for the courts to step in, we're going to leave it to the legislature. I thought that was the kind of decision we would get from the Court of Appeals. And while there are certainly plenty of elements in that in the court's decision, there's also an element, very strong, more than an element, an argument that the reason that gay people, it was kind of the beginning of what we call now the accidental procreation argument, or what our team referred to as the slutty heterosexual argument, which is this idea that somehow it's okay to only have marriage for straight people because only straight people can accidentally get pregnant, and if they do, you really, really, really want them to get married. I have no problem with the idea that government really, really wants people to get married. It's better for kids if their parents are married. But that doesn't explain, it really doesn't explain. Imagine a teenage girl, and she gets pregnant by mistake. The idea that she would decide to get married to the father of her kid because gay people can't makes no sense. But this really was kind of the beginning. I mean, it had already been expressed, but it was certainly the prime judicial articulation of that idea, and it was cited many, many times. It still gets cited today for that.
One of the things I think for people who work with you, who have seen you talking, I mean, you're on TV often talking about these issues, is the extent in the book that you go into your personal life and talk about sort of, in some ways, how your story tracks this larger story. I didn't know, and I will say I'm sort of surprised when I read it that you had actually met Thea.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that?
Sure. So let me say a few things. So first of all, my best friend in New York joked when I told her that I was going to have some personal stuff in the book. She said, "I don't understand why you're doing that." She's like, "It's not like," she's like, "you have the most boring personal life of anyone I know." She's like, "It's not like you've like overcame a cocaine habit or something." She's like, "What are you? Why would anyone want to read about your personal life?" But as and that was not the original conception for the book. The original conception was just to write about how we won the Windsor case. But I realized as we started to kind of organize the chapters that I couldn't tell that story really without telling my own story. Because, you know, I remember growing up as a kid in the 70s, you know, Gloria Steinem, I think it was, said that the personal was political. Whether or not you believe that about every issue, certainly about the issue of gay rights, the personal is the political. And it was impossible for me to explain, I think, how the world had changed for everyone and how we were able to convince the court that the world had changed and we should win without explaining how I had changed. So here's the personal story that I grappled with, but I decided to tell in the book. So in 2009, Thea Spire passed away. And when I got the call from someone to see if I wanted to represent a woman by the name of Edie Windsor, I had never met Edie Windsor before then. But I knew exactly who she was. And the reason that I knew exactly who she was almost 20 years before, when I had been graduating my third year of law school. I was definitely a late bloomer. So I did not even think about having the courage to be a lesbian or to act on be a lesbian or to tell anyone I was a lesbian until the bitter end of my third year of law school. And it just so happened that my parents that summer, I was moving to Boston to clerk, but my parents were visiting me in New York, and my bad luck, it was the Gay Pride weekend. And as my parents were coming to my studio apartment on the Upper West Side to see me, they kind of had to snake their way through the parade. And when they got to my apartment, my mom was in high form and had a lot of not so pleasant things to say about. And in fact, my college roommate had been the daughter of the then Manhattan Borough President Ruth Messinger, and she had been marching in the parade. So my mom went on and on about why is Ruth Messinger proud of the fact that her daughter's a lesbian and why is she marching in the parade. And so I basically said after a certain point in time, you got to stop. I can't do, you know, stop. Enough, Mom. And my mom's a pretty smart woman, and she said, well, why are you saying that? Are you gay? I said, yes. And my mom did not have the ideal reaction that you would want your parent to have. Now, let me be very clear about this. She's apologized 7,000 times. It's something that she totally feels terrible regret for, and people can apologize, and they can get over it, and they can evolve, and that's a good thing. So this is not a criticism of my mom. But as you can imagine, having gotten that reaction, I was not, you know, it was a tough time in my life, and I was probably as low as I've ever been. And so I started asking around in New York, I need to see a psychologist, and this is the way people spoke back then, who knows gay issues or who gets gay issues, that's what I said. And I kept getting the same name back. I kept getting Thea Spire. So I actually saw Thea Spire as a patient on two occasions only, because I was moving to Boston, in the apartment where I ultimately met Edie in 2009. She was already a quadriplegic. And so she saw her patients in her apartment. And during those sessions, here's the really incredible thing. You know, I think this is pretty rare for a psychologist, but during those sessions, she talked to me about Edie. Looking back on it, I think she was trying to say to me, because I was so dubious that I could ever be happy, that I could ever have a life that I wanted, I think she felt that unless she told me about Edie, I would never believe her. So she told me about Edie, and I think she was trying to say, you can have this life too. And she described Edie to me as this incredibly brilliant math genius who'd studied at NYU. So flash forward, it's 2009. I walk into Edie's apartment. I expect to see a woman with like a slide rule, you know, flannel shirt, thick glasses. And when Edie opens the door, like I was dumbstruck. I mean, I basically said to her, you're not at all what I imagined. I've been here before. I told her immediately why I knew that. And then I told her why. And the incredible thing about it is, even though it was all those years later, and even though my parents, as I said before, had completely changed on this, I mean, completely embraced my life and my wife and our son and everything else, it was like all those feelings that I had in 1991 came right back to me. And before Ian and I even talked about the case, I said, you have to give me a minute, because I've been here before, and then I explained to her why.
I thought that was sort of, I mean, when we talk about how much things have changed and we talk about sort of where the country has gone, it's incredible how new this all is in some ways. And it's when you read something like that and see like this is in the span of like one person's life that this has gone from somebody looking for like getting the same name from everybody for who you can talk to, a therapist, about gay issues, to a plaintiff like Edie. And so let's talk a little bit about that. The one, when you're describing it, the section I'm going to read, because it just really struck me in light of some other things. On page 96, if you have your own. Then one day in 1977, as they were preparing for a trip to Japan, they realized that Thea had started to drag one foot when she walked. That began a whole new chapter in their lives. It's really incredible to me how similar Edie and Jim's stories are. Jim Obergefell, the marriage plaintiff in Ohio. There's basically that same exact sentence in my profile of Jim.
Yeah.
When John was first starting to exhibit his symptoms of ALS more seriously, it was literally a foot before dragging before they were going on an overseas flight. When you put together that this potential client, or you immediately took the case, that this client was Thea's wife, and this case was going forward. How you talk, that pretty much the whole second half of the book is you talking about how the story is Edie, and
right.
The case is Edie, and the argument is Edie.
Right.
What was it about her story that you believed made it so worthwhile for so much attention to be placed on one person?
So, first of all, I mean, in terms of the similarities between the Obergefell case and their story and Thea's story, I mean, again, you know, let's be honest about this. The truth of the matter is that when does marriage matter the most? Sadly, it matters the most when bad stuff happens. That's when it matters. When someone gets sick, God forbid, when someone dies, when a couple splits up and you have to worry about the children, that's when marriage matters. And so I don't think it's at all coincidental that these key marriage decisions arise in a context where, God forbid, you know, it happens, a spouse has suffered a terrible illness and then passes away. Mm-hmm. In terms of Edie, it was just, again, having learned that lesson of the New York case of having, you know, kind of too many couples in the background, it was so clear to me immediately that it was the perfect case. And there were a whole bunch of factors that went into it. The first and foremost, obviously, is the fact that this was a marriage. You know, I mean, think about it. No one knows in life what's going to happen to you, sadly. And no one knows. Anyone could wake up the next morning and get a terrible diagnosis like the diagnosis that Thea got. But I think the one thing we do know is if, God forbid, that happens to any of us, we would want to have a spouse like Edie Windsor. This is a couple, you know, they had a post-it on their refrigerator that said, "Seize joy." And they made sure that diagnosis, when it happened, and it happened to both of them, did as little as possible to change Thea's life. In fact, the day she died, she was seeing patients that day who had to be called. So, number one, this was a marriage truly in sickness and in health, truly till death of them part. And I knew people would get that in a fancy legal term in their kishkas. They would understand what that was. Second of all, to be blunt, just look at Edie. You know, it doesn't hurt to have a plaintiff who is incredibly charismatic, incredibly articulate, incredibly intelligent, and is incredibly beautiful. You know, she, for those of you who haven't seen her picture, I can't believe there's anyone here who hasn't, but needless to say, she did not look like a lesbian in a flannel shirt and a slide rule and thick glasses. That's not really her image, and that didn't hurt. And then on top of that, I think the fact that it was a tax case, ironically, I think ended up being an incredibly powerful thing. You know, first of all, what caused the case is that Edie had to pay this huge inheritance tax because of DOMA when Thea passed away. And so it was really a tax on being gay. And it was enough money, it was $350,000, that I thought, you know, that's real damage. And every American would get in their guts, again, what it means to have to pay an unjust tax.
And what about one of the interesting things when you were talking about that in the book, you talk about the fact that you did get some advice about like removing that information and not talking about it because then she's this rich woman in New York and why should we care?
Right. What? So there was a lot of concern in the movement that Edie would be perceived as too rich and it was not a good case for that reason. I had a bunch of reactions to that. First of all, I tend to represent people who have a significant amount of money, so it didn't really bother me. I was like, compared to some of my other clients, she's really not that rich. And the truth of the matter is she really isn't that rich. I mean, most of the estate tax was because they bought an apartment in New York in 1980 for hardly anything, and it appreciated like anything in New York. So that was really the cause of the estate tax there. So that was my view of that. Number two, again, you know, there I had a real concern. I think judges, and this ended up being very important. Our Second Circuit judge, the chief judge, was Dennis Jacobs at the time, who sat on the panel. And when I was preparing for the Second Circuit argument, I listened to and read all his essays. And he'd given this lecture at the Federalist Society where he said he really criticized public interest groups who had made up cases. He said he did not approve of that. So I was, even before I knew Dennis Jacobs was ever going to be on the case, I was really concerned about this perception that it was made up, that we were creating a case. And my view is you pay $350,000 to the government, you want your money back, that's not made up. That's a real case. And one of the issues that we had early on is Edie, I think at an early press conference, said something like, "Oh, I don't care about getting my money back." And I pulled her aside afterwards and I said, first of all, that isn't true. You actually do care about you getting your money back. And second of all, please do not say that. That is not a helpful thing for you to say. You should want your money back. And my 7-year-old son, when you ask him what the case is about, he said, Edie wants her money back. So at least my son was well-trained.
There's another thing that you didn't want Edie to say.
Yeah, so the other thing she did at the same press conference is some young person very nicely asked her, her advice for how she stayed together with Thea for so long. The immediately thing she said is, my advice to a long-term relationship is keep it hot. And then she proceeded to go into great detail about how to keep it hot. And I was sitting there, I mean, people know me well, know I'm pretty prude anyway, but I was sitting there like literally wanting to die. And during that same conversation, I said to her, look, we have to have another rule. I don't want the justices of the Supreme Court reading about how to keep it, your advice about how to keep it hot. That's not helpful. As soon as this case is over, you can talk about it all you want. I don't care, but you can't talk about it during the case. She followed the rule, but the minute we won the case, all bets were off.
I will tell you, I knew that rule because you did have to actually say it out loud to Edie while we were doing
her interview.
Right, people, after they accepted.
Because people would, reporters like Chris would ask her questions about what was it like in the bar scene in New York, and she would want, and I'd be like, oh no, we're not talking about the '60s bar scene in New York.
The one thing. So many questions that we could do this for 2-3 hours and be fine. And I think other people have their own
questions.
And we
already have done that many times.
Yeah, and we've done several times. Want to talk a little bit about the importance of DOJ when the Department of Justice did decide to basically switch sides and declare that their view was that DOMA was unconstitutional. What was it like? I think most people in the audience probably paid attention to that happening if they decided to come out here tonight.
Right.
But as a lawyer going through that, what was that like?
So, you know, that was the one thing in the case. I mean, I hope this doesn't sound conceited, but that was the one thing in the case that really surprised me. I thought when we filed the case that we would win at the district court. I thought when we filed the case that we would win in the Second Circuit. I'm a New York lawyer. I thought I could predict how those judges would react to the case. I had no idea. I knew a case would get to the Supreme Court. I had no idea that it would be our case. I knew that that was a crapshoot, and so we weren't really thinking about that too much. But I never thought that the government would change positions. And it's actually an incredible story. I got a call early in the case from a very lovely woman who was the trial lawyer for the DOJ, and she said to me, I think their brief, Sharon would know this better than me, but I think the government's brief was due like in a week or two. And she said, I need an extension. And, you know, as a lawyer, Paul Weiss, I don't get to represent plaintiffs very much. So I was psyched. And I said, forget about it. You know, we're the plaintiff. I know my job is to move this case along. I mean, there were real reasons too.
When you wanted to move it along because other cases were ahead of you.
Well, and Edie had two heart attacks during the case. And my goal from day one was I want her to be not only alive when this case is over, but I want her to be able to enjoy it. And so I didn't want there to be any delay. I mean, we had two very serious heart episodes during the case. So I said, forget about it. No extension. You know, go pound salt. See you later. I then got another call back from kind of the mid-level DOJ lawyer who said, look, Robbie, you know, we're asking you for an extension. We need to figure out what to do in this case. And again, you know, we can all be too cynical in the world because I thought he was full of it. You know, I'm like, he just wants delay and I don't want there to be delay. So forget about it. No extension. About 20 minutes later, I get a third call, and this time it was from Tony West, who was then, I think, third at the DOJ. And Tony said, Robbie, he said, what's this I hear about you telling two DOJ lawyers that you were giving them an extension? He's like, is that true? I said, yeah. And he said, are you kidding me? He said, I'm telling you that the president and the attorney general and I want to consider what to do in this case, and we need an extension in order to do that. And first I tried to negotiate with him. I said, okay, Tony, you can have the extension, but I want you to agree that we have no standing issues in the case. And he was like, forget about it. He's like, I'm not giving you anything. I'm telling you I want a 30-day extension. And I said, okay, let me think about it. I'll call you back. I hung up the phone. I went next door. I have a very dear friend, Marty Flumenbaum, whose office next door to me. I told him the story. He said, are you insane? Like, you're the president's asking you for an extension. You should give the extension. So I came back in the room and I said, okay,
Tony.
This
is where New York lawyers get their reputation from.
This is all true. I know. I'm not proud of this. This is all true. I came back on the phone and I said, Tony, okay, you can have the extension. But then I couldn't help myself, as my son would say. So I said to him, but Tony, and there was some not a small degree of sarcasm in my voice when I said this. I said, but Tony, I want you to know that when you and the president and the attorney general talk about this, I can't believe I had the nerve to say this, I want you to know that I'll be praying for you. And that's how, and I was sarcastic about it because I didn't think they were going to be talking about it. And that's how the phone call ended. Almost exactly 30 days later, it was spring vacation. We were on vacation with my family. And I get an email that morning saying that Tony West would like to have a phone call. So I don't, you don't get that many calls as a private attorney. I was like, we knew immediately what it was. We all got on the phone. I literally had tears running down my face. I mean, I may be hard bitten, but I was crying during the entire call. Tony explained that he and the president and Attorney General Holder had gone through the traditional factors for heightened scrutiny. They concluded that gay people should get heightened scrutiny and that they wouldn't be defending DOMA in this case. And then at the end of the call, Tony said to me, he said, Robbie, he said, you remember that thing you said to me about praying for me and the president? I said, yeah, I remember that. He said, well, I just want you to know, he said, sometimes prayer works. And that was the end of the call. And look, the truth of that is, it was an incredibly moving moment for so many reasons. But the truth is, I think the lesson that I've drawn from that is that we can all be too cynical about things, especially here in D.C. or in New York, on the Eastern Seaboard, in this world of Twitter and Instagram. You know, we all can assume that everything that gets done for some other non-principled reason. You know, sometimes people do things because it's the right thing to do, and sometimes elected officials do things because it's the right thing to do, and there's no question in my mind that that's what happened there.
For DC lawyers, for lawyers in the room, for people who love the legal process, we're not going to get into it here because it would just go on forever, but highly recommend the book for its discussion of Robbie's moots before the Supreme Court argument. It is some real internal discussion about what it's like to be a lawyer preparing to argue at the Supreme Court. The last question I want to ask you before we open it up is to talk about the fact that you're not done. You have adopted Mississippi as your legal gay legal state.
Absolutely.
You after winning Windsor, you filed lawsuit, won at the trial court level on Mississippi's marriage ban. After Obergefell came down, you've now got another case relating to adoption. Do you want to update people on where that's
Yeah,
at?
So when we first went down to Mississippi and met with the couples down there, the bigger problem actually they had at the time was, I don't even think they expected they would ever get married. That wasn't really a realistic expectation on their part. But they did want to be able to adopt their own children. You know, there were a lot of lesbian couples where only the biological mother was the legal parent. Mississippi has a law in the books that says gay couples cannot adopt. And that was really the bigger problem that they had. And what we said to them is, let's do marriage first. We have a better shot at getting marriage right now, and then we'll come back and we'll do the adoption ban. And that's what we're doing now. We filed a case, I guess, about a month ago. Mississippi's the last state that has any prohibition on gay couples adopting. I'm a pretty conservative lawyer. I don't like to predict our chances of winning, but I'm willing to predict that we have a very good chance of winning this case. So we have a hearing. The state really doesn't want to engage with us on the merits. I should actually send my draft to Marty Lederman, who's an expert on this, but the brief is all about why the court should not reach the merits of the case. I'm pretty confident that they will. And the hearing's on November 6th, and I'm going to bring my whole family down because we've made tons of friends, and my son has friends who are kids down there, and we're all going to hang out together. Hopefully I'll win, otherwise I won't be such a great kid.
All right, I think we're going to open it up for questions. Do we have... Where are the mics that...
And I should say, wait, let me just say that my client in the case is sitting right here, Emily Heck McGowan from Family Equality Council.
All right, so there's microphones at either side of the room. Anybody wants to go ahead and get up, ask a question, that's fine.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, come on, guys. If I could take, you know, some of the justices' questions, I can probably handle yours. I hope.
All right. I'll jump in. Thank you for coming. It's lovely to see you. So my question is, the morning of, did you and your legal team, did you just take a moment to go, I know we're really busy doing last minute stuff, maybe at breakfast. I know a lot of legal teams have pre-oral argument breakfast.
Yeah.
Did you have a moment where you said, let's just have a moment together and realize that we're here and this is amazing?
Well, you're assuming a certain amount of sanity on my part, which probably is too much, too great of an assumption. Look, I mean, we didn't have an early morning breakfast. I'm embarrassed to say this. We had an early morning blowout. I was obsessed with making sure that my hairdo was perfect during the argument. And so we had a hairdresser at the hotel, and I had been given advice, or we had a joke on the team that I was going to make sure that my hair was at least as high, if not higher, than Nancy Pelosi's. And she knows about it, too, and she agrees with me that I definitely succeeded that day. It was definitely at least a little bit higher than Nancy Pelosi. So we did that together. The team was run by women, so women were it was like kind of a coffee klatch at 4 a.m. And then we went over to the court, and actually we got lost on the way over to the court. The driver started to get on the highway, and I kind of had a nervous breakdown. There was some sense of that. I mean, we'd had a lot of laughter in the months preparing, and there have been a lot of times where, you know, I think we kind of downplayed in a way to be able to handle the tension and the gravity of it by joking. But certainly afterwards, I think we all felt that. I mean, we all got together that evening, and it was a pretty incredible set of cocktails that we all had together.
Justice Kennedy seems to be very focused on adoptions and children in these situations.
I agree, Judge, in Mississippi.
Do you know where that, Anthony Kennedy.
Yes, no, I understand.
Okay. Do you know where that comes from, and why did you choose to go the adoption route in Mississippi?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't know Justice Kennedy personally. As you could imagine, I spent a lot of time reading his cases, particularly his cases on gay rights. We had this cheat sheet that we called the Kennedy Greatest Hits, with kind of his best language that I kind of read out loud for about 24 hours before the argument, so it would be on the tip of my tongue. People, I'm sure, thought I was a lunatic as I was walking through the hotel. I don't know. I mean, you know, he's also very focused on this sense of dignity, you know, this view that all humans have dignity. I don't, you know, you'd have to talk to him. My personal view is that it comes, and I think this is okay. We have separation of church and state in this country, but I think Justice Kennedy is a religious man, and I think he believes as a religious principle that all human beings have dignity. And I think it's important in a lot of ways, and this was another theme in the case, that we don't cede the religious aspects of this only to one side. It's not only religious people who believe that gay people shouldn't get married. There are plenty of religious people who think that every human being was created in the image of God, and that governments at least have to respect that. So, but that's the best I can offer. But there's no question that he feels that, and all the language about the dignity of families and humiliating children whose parents are disrespected, you can imagine that language is cited over and over and over again in our briefs in Mississippi.
Hello, thanks for coming to Washington. We've crossed paths a lot, and I've been looking forward to meeting you. I was really excited in 2009 and when I first heard about the case, because I am an estate planning attorney, and hearing the facts right away, it seemed like total winner because nobody understands it. So the question that I have is, how did you tackle the subject matter of, you know, the initial facts being a tax case, and also the idea that you went from being a corporate lawyer doing big cases at the firm to working with an individual client, and how did that arrangement come up initially?
Well, you know, I work with individual clients, whether it's a company or a person. I'm used to working with individual clients, and my wife says that I have this, what she says is an amazing ability to persuade myself that no matter who my client is, they've never done anything wrong. They're absolutely right. There's no weaknesses to their case. And I put myself in that mindset. I believe, I mean, this is going to sound anachronistic, sadly, in my view, but I believe that the skills of being a lawyer or being a great litigator are the skills of being a great litigator. And the ability to tell a story and to have credibility and to be persuasive and all those things are what matters in winning cases. And it's great to have knowledge about a particular area of the law, of course. In certain areas of the law, you have to have expertise, antitrust, patent, et cetera. But what's most important is having those skills as being a great litigator. And I think from the very beginning, you know, we had this post-it, we had this theme, it's all about Edie Stupid, borrowing from the Clinton campaign. And our view was, how were we going to win the case? We were going to win the case by persuading the judges, and if it got there, the justices, that the marriage and the relationship that Edie and Thea had was the same as the marriage of anyone else, including the estate tax.
Anyone else?
I've actually got a quick question.
Sure.
Robbie, your son's name is Jacob, correct?
Correct.
All right. At the end of the book, one of the most powerful sentences to me in the entire book was right after the ruling was handed down. Your wife said to you, everything is going to be different for Jacob now. Has it hit him yet? Does he know?
Yes, and the answer is yes and no. So he's a kid. So, there was this summer after we won. The summer of 2013 was kind of the summer of euphoria in my life. I always, to describe to people, I said I was kind of like the guy in the Chagall paintings, like floating over their own life. That's how it felt. And I think the high point of that was a family, it was like a Friday evening, and we decided we were going to have family movie night. And my wife and I put our foot down, and we said, I cannot do another Disney cartoon. I'm sorry. I know you love them. I can't do Aladdin. I just can't do it. Mommy and I are going to pick the movie. And so we picked My Fair Lady. And he loved it. He watched the entire movie. It's not a short movie. He was about 7 at the time, I guess. And at the end, he said, I have 2 questions, which is amazing. He actually managed to hold his questions to the end of the movie. And he said, I have 2 questions. He said, one, he said, I don't understand why she went back to Professor Higgins. He's like, he treated her so badly. Why did she do that? My wife and I were beaming with pride. We're like, we're clearly doing something right, if that's what he says. And then his second question, he said, I guess this is an old-fashioned movie. And we said, yeah, Jacob, it's an old-fashioned movie. He said, yeah. He said, I bet this movie was made before men could marry men. And it took a couple seconds like that, and then it hit us that in my son's worldview, something is old-fashioned if it happened before men could marry men. That's the greatest thing we accomplished in this case.
All right, if y'all will.
Can I add one thing? Just I was the second co-parent adoption in Cook County, 95, summer of 95. So my daughter is just 20. And we went to the Supreme Court the day the decision came down. It was tremendous. You know, what will Jacob think? Sorry, I'm getting so emotional. But it was amazing to be there with her. And it was amazing for her, you know, as this young woman coming into her own, to think how powerful it was. I mean, she saw it in terms of me and my ex and what we'd been through. But she also saw it for her future. So thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, will help me in thanking these two.